getting the participants getting ready to get busy, and that'll be Joe Mascaro and Steve King.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the world-famous Philadelphia Spectrum. For another action-packed card of championship wrestling, this evening's matches are sanctioned and supervised by the Pennsylvania State Athletic Commission. Howard McCall is your commissioner. Chief Deputy Commissioners this evening are Nick Santoro and John Esposito. The attending physician is Dr. Strickland. Timekeeper at the bell, J.P. Mina. The referees this evening, Dick Worley, Barney Solomon, Dusty Feldbomber, and Gilberto Roman. And I'm your ring announcer from All-Star Wrestling, Gary Michael Capetta. This is the first event of the evening. It is set for one fall with a 20-minute time limit. Introducing to my right from Panama City, Panama, weighing 221 pounds, Steve King. And his opponent from Concordville, Pennsylvania, weighing 228 pounds, Joe Mascaro.
Well, fans, you saw the gentleman's handshake. We're not too sure which way this is going to go tonight. Of course, both pretty much, I would say Steve King probably has a little more body weight than Joe Mascaro. Mascaro has been here a time or two in the past, as you may recall, here on Prison Speckling as wrestling. But we speculate that he'll do rather well for himself tonight. But let's just see what's happening as they start to feel each other out, just sort of get a little bit of a warm-up here before they really get underway. Sort of circling one another, trying to psych each other out perhaps before they now make contact again. What a great evening of wrestling, as we said at the outset, and we'll tell you more about that a little bit later on. There's a clean break on the ropes. Steve King with his back to us at the upper part of the ropes, and Mascaro backed off like a gentleman, and we'll see how long this lasts, and perhaps they'll be gentlemen all the way. There's a side headlock by Mascaro, Steve King, to get his attention, and suppose he is. That's a shoulder block as Steve King is down. Mascaro trying another shoulder block, but no. Looked to be he started the shoulder block and then had something else in mind as he was in the midst of that approach. Steve King's been around before, you know. He's not an old fella at wrestling, but he's an old timer in the sense he's very ring-wise. Nice takedown by Steve King. And it's a count of two. Mascaro's got to be alert because He better keep his mind on those. Another count of two. The referee right on the scene. He's watching everything very critically. Well, Steve King is exerting a great deal of arm pressure, but there's a hip roll. Okay, not bad. Nice break in the hold by Joe Mascaro. And a little psyching job there, coming off the knees to his feet in one motion is Steve King. They use a lot of psychological ploys here. There's a leg takedown, and Steve King has not really wasn't in a position for a three count countdown on Joe Mascaro. Oh, he's twisting the left leg to gain a little psychological edge here, because I think when one wrestler holds a bit of an edge over the other, as much as seemingly has him in, there's another count of two, as one wrestler over another has him in a position where he's flat down, he's exerting pressure on a limb, a leg, or an arm, that doesn't scare the other guy, but it does let him know the other fellow is pretty much in command. He's very much in pain right now. He's still trying to get up. The referee asking, do you give in? Do you submit? He said, no. There's another count of one. Mascaro knows by now he's got to be pretty quick, because these counts are rather fast. All right, nice kick by Mascaro. And King heading off his back, and with one move right on his feet again. Beautiful move, indicating he's in great shape tonight. A little more rest. wrestling next month here in September at the Spectrum. Tell you about that date a little bit later on. All right, there's another shoulder block on Steve King by Joe Mascara. Oh, and a takedown, and what do we have here? Oh, the referee was not in position. Referee was not in position. By the time you get over there, why, the hold was broken. Both wrestlers are back on their feet again. That could have been a pin. Count of two, but Mascara wiggles out of it. Ah, he's indicating what's with the fast count, huh? He said your shoulders were down. What do you want from me? But it did seem like a pretty fast count. Some seem faster than others, fans. All right, the hip roll takedown and Mascara, but he's underneath the rope, so.
What is this?
Steve King, one, two. Well, how about the third man in the squared circle? He's got his job to do, whether you like it or not, and whether you think it's a fast count or not, as Joe Mascara does. He's calling it as he sees it. There's a headlock by Mascara on Steve King. Nothing much happening right here. He's hardly in a position to pin. King showing just how fast he is, and now we go back one way or the other. It's a matter of who can hold on long enough. The fans responding here to one pin move on one or the other. Ooh, Mascara knew that was close. He felt that third count coming on. He quickly got to his feet. Both these guys in excellent shape, and as we said at the outset, and you can see that as we keep our camera trained on them. They are really in good shape. Very quick, very agile. See the man hardly breathing tonight. Mascara, as I said, is from the suburbs of Chester County, Concord. Though he really hasn't developed a big following here yet. Well, it could be. He's a comer. Could be. Looking forward to the arrival tonight later on of Andre the Giant, whom we haven't seen here at the Spectrum for what, 4 or 5 months, maybe? Not that long. Memory fails at times. Okay, they're on the ropes. They should break this, and it is a clean break. Good deal. We've got 8 big matches tonight, fans. This is one of the 8. Johnny Valiant going against popular Bob Backlund. Andre the Giant taking on undefeated Jerry Valiant. Greg Valentine against Steve Strongbow tonight. I'll tell you, the action's right here at the Philadelphia Spectrum. It is right here. Well, it's a nice hold here, but no way we get a pin, so that's pretty much it. A lot of pressure being exerted by Joe Mascara on the left leg of Steve King, who's handling it well enough. Uh-oh, King coming back with a hold of his own, and now trying for a pin. There's a count of two. Referee had his hand just about ready to go on down to the canvas again. Here at ringside fading the referee, who's only doing his job. Oh, nice, and a kick out by Joe Mascara, showing his agility, as we said a while ago. Both these guys are very evenly matched. I would say Joe Mascara being a little more volatile by nature, Steve King very cool, very quietly cool, and very studiously examining Mascara at every turn. Looking for an advantage. Ooh, into the ring turnbuckles, and he takes it in the small of his back. That's smart. It really does. And the double. All right, that was it. You saw it and heard it. One, two, three, and that's it. Mascara going at the referee tonight, claiming all evening long during this match about the fast count, and he thinks he was the victim of it. And very, very nicely laid out by Steve King.
The time of the match, 9 minutes, 22 seconds, and your winner, Steve King.
All right, that's it. They shook hands, and though Mascara didn't like the outcome, why, he's got to go along with it.
Ladies and gentlemen, a reminder for you to watch All-Star.
Okay, take a look at your screens at home there, fans. You'll see the events leading up to the pin now, and there's the... whip into the ropes, into the turnbuckle. Flying through the air is Mascara, quickly turning around and setting up the pin, both shoulders down, and there's a count of three, and there's your pin. Steve King over Joe Mascara. Well, all right. You saw some nice action there. You're going to see more on Prism Television in September because we have premiere movies for you. First of all, The Midnight Express, starring Brad Davis. If you never saw that before, you get a chance, you Prism subscribers on the Prism Network. Also, we have Invasion of the Body Snatchers with Donald Sutherland. We have Return from Witch Mountain with Betty Davis starred. And then, also premiering, A Wedding, starring Carol Burnett, Desi Arnaz, and Mia Farrow. And then comes The Horseman, Jane Fonda, James Caan, The Driver, Ryan O'Neill, Attack of the Killer Tomatoes, plus many, many more. So lots of happening here on Prism Television. And, of course, Gorilla Monsoon joins us here at the Spectrum ringside tonight for a bit of action. Gorilla, welcome here.
Thank you very much.
I've been following your events in the newspaper, Philadelphia Journal, carrying your column every Wednesday, and I've been following that.
Well, thank you very much. I know we've had many, many letters come in. Seems to be a very popular column. We have quite a bit of mail, and I'm very happy with it, and happy about it, and I'll have a special announcement to all those people that are writing to me a little later in the program.
Very good.
I'm going to be with you sporadically here tonight, Dick. They've given me 1,800 other assignments, so I'm going to be moving in and out to see the best I can do to stay with you for a while.
Well, we'll talk about that a little bit later on, but right now the boos and the hisses for Bulldog Brower, who's ringside, as you can see, on the top of the ring apron, and he'll be going in just a moment or two against Pete Sanchez. Sanchez already in the ring.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is the second bout of the evening, also scheduled as a one-fall contest with a 20-minute time limit, and here are your principals. First, introducing in the corner to my left, hailing from Toronto, Canada, his weight 271 pounds, Dick, the Bulldog Brower. And his opponent standing in the corner to my right from Brooklyn, New York, weighing in at 240 pounds, Pete Sanchez.
Well, this should be a pretty interesting match. Pete is no stranger to this squared circle out there. He'll give Bulldog all he wants for his money, I guarantee you that.
Well, the other thing is we don't know where Bulldog's coming from, either.
Oh, he doesn't either.
Enough. Otherwise,
he was lost out there in the parking lot. I found him up by the ramp area there. Wanted to know which way to Veterans Stadium.
All right, enough said.
Never know what the Bulldog is thinking.
That's for sure. I think he gets his messages from outer space somewhere, I think. All right, a little preliminary contact here and on the ropes. Earlier in the...
doesn't waste any time.
I was going to say there's a departure. We had Joe Mascara and Steve King a moment ago, and they shook hands before and after. And on the ropes are nice breaks. We don't expect that here, though.
No, you won't see any handshaking in this bout. You don't see that.
Nope.
A handful of hair. But the extent of... Oh, double handful of hair. The Bulldog, at times, seems he doesn't know wrist watch from wrist watch, but I know better. He does know wrestling. Maybe he's forgotten it. I don't. certainly is an awesome sight in there to see that 270 or 79 pounds coming at you constantly. He never lets up.
No, he doesn't, and that's the scary part. Just keeps coming at you. All right, a little arm twist. Showing some pressure on the upper shoulder area by Brower on his opponent.
This is very unlike the Bulldog. He usually doesn't pick out one part of the body and work on it. He just hammers away and hits everything. He's going to work on this armbar now, even though a handful of hair was necessary to bring Pete down.
You hinted in one of your columns this past month or so that you might be on the verge of retiring. What do you have to say?
Well, I'm trying to retire. They just won't let me.
It's a nice feeling.
I won't book myself as such for a match. If the promoter asked me specifically to do a match, I might consider it. The State Athletic Commission asked me to do it, but I really don't enjoy climbing in there anymore. The injuries that I got 10 years ago are killing me today. So what's going to happen to the injuries I receive now?
Yeah, they never go away, do they?
No, they never go away. It's nights like tonight when it's damp outdoors, and the rain is coming down. The old calcium deposits that have formed over all the years from all the broken bones really take their toll on you.
Yeah. Well, there's that Pittsburgh pain, the one in the elbow there. I remember that 2 years ago.
Oh, my God.
Whoa!
Brower invited that, and he didn't like it when he got it. He said, wait a minute, let's talk this over.
Right, let's be friends.
I'll time out and go to the locker room.
Ooh!
Sanchez buried one right into LeBron's there. He's coming out strong now. Fans are saying, don't wait, go ahead and do it.
Well, the fans are not buying this. They know better.
Sanchez went away from the wrestling business for a while. He and his dad opened up a restaurant in New York City, and once this gets in your blood, it gets tough to stay away from it. Bruno Sammartino has tried to stay away from it unsuccessfully on a number of occasions. It gets in your blood, it gets under your skin, it's difficult.
Well, how do you think you'll handle it? You know, like everything, eventually, someday you're going to have to retire, but though you remain on the periphery of it. You are involved with it.
Well, I'm still involved with wrestling in many aspects of it. As far as actually climbing in there and taking the punishment and dealing it out anymore, I don't know whether I'm too happy about that or not. Of course, something could change my mind. The Bulldog is about to roll out on us here, but...
Well, we'll back off.
Bulldog's upset. We got a couple of shots blocked and walked right into that right hand. Sanchez, very clever, very quick. I don't know whether you've told our viewers yet or not, Dick, that we do not have a September date in here.
I thought we did.
We're back in here October 20th.
I had it around the 15th. Okay.
No, definitely will not be in this building in September.
Okay.
Due to a booking commitment somewhere else, I guess.
Okay.
Somebody got their wires crossed, but we'll be back here October 20th. It's a shame. This is right across the bridge for me. I'm right at home here.
That's for sure.
Brower with a chin lock now. Just trying to slow Pete down a little bit, I think. It's not the type of hold you're going to beat somebody with. Of course, the Bulldog's really, he's never interested in whether he wins or loses, just how much punishment can he inflict on his opponent.
Just wants to make contact, that's all.
Of course, he does get upset when he collects that 30% of the purse as opposed to 70.
Yeah.
Well, we've got some fantastic matches here tonight.
I'll tell you.
Vince McMahon, the voice of wrestling, has just arrived here, and lucky for me, he's going to relieve me of my responsibility here tonight. And I'm going to turn it over to him, Dick, and I'll see you later.
All right, good. All right, a little pinch hit duty here. A Gorilla Monsoon for Vince McMahon, who's about ready to join us. We'll have the headset on in just a moment. We'll pick up where we had left off. Vince McMahon with us at ringside now. Just came in from the north.
Yes, indeed. A very cloudy and rainy north.
We are delayed on the plane, or?
Oh, I'll say. Looks like Brower's getting the worst into this match.
Well, he started out all right, but now he's starting to get these lumps. And Sanchez looks to be in pretty good shape after a layoff, as Gorilla Monsoon indicated a little while ago. All right, he's getting a count on him, huddled in the corner there. Sanchez still very much ready to do battle. Very good shape. We had Steve King and a local guy whom we saw a few months ago, Joe Mascara, go at it just a little while ago in our first match this evening, and Steve King for the pin. Look, we've got a big lineup tonight. Andre the Giant with us. The Valiants are in town. Backlund's in town. I understand it's Backlund's birthday, Vince. Is that true?
Yes, indeed. I think he's 25.
No. Nobody's 25.
He'd like to be 25.
Oh! Bulldog didn't get around fast enough and took a couple shots to the back of the head.
Sanchez is really a fiery fellow, though. I'll tell you, he likes to dish it as well as receive it.
Up for this one or not. No place to go. He's looking to grab hold of something or somebody, but
Brower doesn't seem to have the fire that he used to have. I don't know. It seems as though he's lost a little something as of late in any event.
I think you'd probably be correct in saying that, Vince.
He had a title opportunity with Bob Backlund, and when he couldn't capitalize on the opportunity, I think he just was so dejected after that, everything just kind of fell apart.
Well, you know, Vince, if you can't get up for the championship, I don't say he was holding back. I wouldn't imply that. But if you can't get up for a championship match when the belt's at stake, I don't know what you can do. You know, it's there for the taking, in a sense.
Sanchez continuing to work on the left arm and shoulder. Normally that is not such a vulnerable point, but I suppose if you work on it hard enough, anything becomes a vulnerable point.
Well, maybe at this point in time, Brower's getting to be very vulnerable. Nothing resembling a pin tonight at all so far. It's been mostly technique and humbling one another, beating on one another, and like that. Uh-oh, on the top of the ropes. No, he decided one more. Oh, that knee stung. Fans not too happy with that one.
Oh, indeed. Definitely not. Mr. Brower, I think, is quite happy to get out of that match, though, with Pete Sanchez with a victory.
I think so. That was a very slow, deliberate count, too. All right, let's watch on the screen now. We're going to pick up the slow-mo. And here we go. We thought he was going up on the ropes, but never looks like him crashing down. And here's the referee now jumping over the body of Brower, and here we go, 1, 2, and 3.
Missed a couple of seconds there on the count. The referee did.
9 minutes, 41 seconds. Your winner, Bulldog Brower.
Well, that announcement doesn't make the fans too happy, but nevertheless, that's the way it is. Sanchez not too happy either, but he's leaving the ring area. And we'll be getting ready for event number 3 here shortly. Since you're from out of town, Vince,
and
I
now,
talked
and
to Vince
I'd like to
to
the ring
Rilla Monsoon a little while ago about the local newspaper article he was writing for the Philadelphia Journal, and I saved these for you so you can watch that on the plane going back tonight if you like.
Thank you very much.
Attention, please, ladies and gentlemen, if there is a William Booth,
all right, before we get underway once again with the event number three here, it'll be S.D. Jones and the Jaguar. Let's talk about the Phillies coming up in September. And lots of action as we've got three very exciting National League clubs coming into the area. And that'll be Chicago meeting the Phillies at the Vet on September 14th. Prism will carry it, of course. September 19th and 20th, it'll be Pittsburgh. Pittsburgh has the Phillies number thus far. We'll find out how they do on these two dates, the 19th and 20th. And then September 26th, it'll be St. Louis. The Cards coming in to do battle with the Phillies. So anything can happen here. And the pennant race is not quite over, although it looks to be going in Pittsburgh's favor. But you'll see it all on Prism Television during the month of September. Not all of it, but those dates that we mentioned.
Ladies and gentlemen, here is your third bout of the evening here at the Spectrum. We have in the far corner, 235 pounds from Colombia, South America. Ladies and gentlemen, the Colombian Jaguar! In this corner.
Well, a handshake by the Jaguar with our referee.
He is at 242 pounds from Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. Special Delivery Jones! Jones! This will be one fall with a 20-minute time limit. Your referee, Dusty Fellbaumer.
I noticed, Vince, that the Jaguar even applauded the announcement of the appearance of S.D. Jones tonight. So
I think we can look for a scientific match. We've seen quite a bit of the Jaguar as of late. I think this is his first appearance at the Spectrum. And we may be seeing more of him should he defeat S.D. Jones, who, as of course you know and everyone knows, is a really tough competitor, S.D. is, as well as a fan favorite, especially here in Philadelphia's hometown.
Right. R.S.D. cool as usual, not too disturbed in any preliminary antics by the Jaguar. To me, the Jaguar is giving up about, 30, 40 pounds in weight, perhaps, Vince. Although he's no small wrestler himself.
No, that's true, but not only is he giving up weight in general, but all of the weight that he is giving up is all power when it comes to S.D. Jones. He has really put together this fellow.
Yes, he is. S.D.'s showing his agility, too, tonight. Perhaps, as you say, Vince, it might be a slight bit scientific.
I think most of the fans, however, Dick, feel that this is Jay Strongbow's type match more than it is Greg Valentine's, but I don't know about that. I'd look for one heck of a match all the way through.
Should be. Saw Valentine, he passed me back in the by the dressing rooms tonight, and he looks in great shape as usual.
And one thing you have to give Greg Valentine, he is all competitor. He never gives up.
That's right.
He bends the rules, and sometimes out and out breaks the rules, but he never gives up. He just keeps coming right at you.
Well, that's the excitement we find here at the Spectrum or wherever else that Greg Valentine wrestles, that he brings it all to you and won't give up until he's really literally counted out or totally down. Of course, this is the third time in the recent months, so to speak, that Valentine and Strongbow will be going at it. But in ringside now, watching the goings on. Nobody near a pin here, just headlocks and what can you say? Hasn't been close to a pin yet.
Nice trip up, nice kick out by SD, but the Jaguar stays on his feet. Uh-huh.
starting to heat up here a little bit.
Okay. Jaguar was taking exception to the kick of SD Jones. And Jones was not, well, he did appear to be kicking. Uh-oh, the Jaguar with a forearm smash. A right hand blocked by Jones, a head block by Jones.
I don't know if Jaguar was ready for that. I don't know whether he was putting it on at the beginning when he was handshaking everybody, the referee and SD Jones, but that's all forgotten right now. S.T. Jones not too inclined to want to shake hands. Nice headbutt there. Got the attention of the Jaguar.
It definitely caught his attention. Aha. Oh. Tried a monkey flip. Couldn't do it.
Well, S.T. says, hey, don't try that with me. I'm too smart. Well, Cole Nelson kind of.
No. Jones has too much power for
that's
him.
That's right.
Last month, I beg your pardon, Dick.
I was going to say, I didn't think he'd get enough of a hold for the full Nelson out on S.D. Jones with his massive neck muscles and shoulder muscles.
Well, they brought him down. Yep. That's surprising, not for long. Jones kicking right out.
You were going to say?
Last month we saw Jones, I think, against Joe Mascara and delivered a series of those headbutts. Mr. Mascara was seeing butterflies for several days thereafter.
Had to be.
Ooh. Again, it seemed to be heating things up here in this match. A little slap of the face, a missed, a right hand, and Jones, a southpaw, lays it in. There's another headbutt.
Oh. All right, S.D. Jones is wild-eyed now.
Jones, believe it or not, you wouldn't know it to see him in the ring at the moment, but he has been accused many times of not being aggressive enough. But such is not the case tonight, at least not thus far.
Seems to be Vince, he has to get super angry for him to really become super aggressive, as you said. In the past, he's been accused of that. Fans murmuring here at ringside tonight.
Jones, again, last month complained of the same thing.
Yeah.
A slow count.
Joe Mascara in the first match tonight was complaining about a slow count. Well, one of the other referees said, come on, let's go faster. When he finally got the count against himself, why, he really had a problem.
I bet he did. That count was a little fast. I don't know. Or at least it was faster than the previous count. Wouldn't you agree, Dick?
We're going to take a stopwatch here.
Whether one was too fast or another was too slow, I don't know, but it seemed a little faster than the previous count.
Well, I'll tell you, the guy's always consistent with his count. That's referee Dick Worley. He's always consistent.
Yes.
Not slow at any time. Get a pin, you better keep it. Well, the shot you see is the shot we see and for our camera, and I don't know that, well, it's sort of a standoff there for a moment. SD's got a little hunk of the, or did have a hunk of the back of the Jaguars outfit. SD Jones plays it pretty much straight, though.
My goodness.
Just picked him up and threw him. Called Welcome to Philadelphia.
Nice takedown by the Jaguar.
Yeah.
Didn't have as much on it as Jones' takedown did earlier, but nevertheless. Oh! Sunset flip. How's it? No. Oh. Yes, sir. Got him.
Tried to wiggle out.
Got
him. Do it.
All right. Jones cannot complain of a slow count there.
No. In fact, that last count a little slower. He might have wiggled out because as the count was made, why he was
it was tight, no doubt about it.
Very tight. All right, check your screens now. We'll check the preliminary moves before the pin. Here we go now. Over the top goes SD, and here comes the pin. Totally helpless is the Jaguar. One, two, and three.
Look at that left shoulder. Almost up as the referee's hand went down.
The time, ladies and gentlemen, 8:29. Your winner, Special Delivery Jones.
Well, Steve Jones gets the dope before the hometown fans here, and he's mighty proud of it.
All right, the fans liking him very much, and
we'll be going with. Ladies and gentlemen, please make note.
Okay, we had announced earlier that we had action here the next month. That'll be delayed to October 20th. Okay, don't forget now the main event, one of the biggies, and this will be the champion, Bob Backlund, taking on John Valiant in this title match tonight, and anything can happen. We'll look to see a lot of action here. Backlund brings it right to you, and of course, John Valiant doesn't back off either.
Well, this is really a great occasion for John Valiant. Having the opportunity to make wrestling history. He being John Guyatt, of course, is the reigning co-holder of the tag team title. And if he could hold two championships at the same time, that's never been done before, at least not in modern-day wrestling history.
Well, there's always a lot on the line here. And, of course, Backlund, I've got to say, is taking on everybody who's been
all shot
at him.
He takes the back seat to no one. He's right out front, raring to go. One of the finest gentlemen as well in professional wrestling, as well as being a great athlete.
All right, in the ring, or coming into the ring now, sporting a nice new mustache. There he is John Valiant. And Dick Worley, the third man in the ring tonight.
Interesting, Dick, that John Guy is not wearing his tag team championship belt. If I were John Guy, I think I would want to wear it, at least to show Mr. Backlund I was a champion, just to remind him just before the match began that I was a champion in my own right.
A good point. I hadn't noticed that. Sure enough, no championship belt.
And here comes Bob Backlund, who is wearing.
Oh, yes, sir. And here it is. Bob Backlund going right after him. John Valiant, look out! Bob Backlund is right up to go! Wow, is he ever! Oh, Backlund
like
just nailed it!
I've never seen Backlund come on like this before.
Oh, you ever recall last month? There goes the referee flying to the other guy!
Last month, John Valiant slapped Bob Backlund during the tag team match several times, if you recall. After doing that, he stayed away from Backlund throughout the rest of the remainder of the match. And this is the first time they've had an occasion to get together. And you can see Bob Backlund has not forgotten what took place in the tag team match last month here at the Spectrum.
Well, John Valiant still lying prostrate on the canvas in our near corner. There's a good shot of him.
Boy, I'll say.
Dick Worley warning Bob Backlund away. I don't know, maybe is this over before it begins? I don't know. There's a count of four now. Well, he's going to be in his seat when he wants to.
Oh, Backlund is some kind of right. He's going to kiss this one. Dick Worley's doing a very good job in there. I think you have to give credit to the referee at this moment. Oh, there's a look at John Guy. He's out of it. The match may be stopped. Backlund going right after him. Worley got him in the face with the elbow. The fans certainly in favor of what Mr. Backlund's doing in the square circle, despite John Valiant's personal feeling.
I don't know how much more Valiant could take. Macho not doing too well tonight. Backlund, I just...
This crowd really picking up the momentum here, and they are certainly behind Bob Backlund 100%.
Well, the crowd really is looking for Backlund to really tear Backlund apart.
That's a good way to break some knuckles. You see Backlund shaking his hand there. Backlund struck John Dryden, appear to be on the upper forehead. Right where the skull is the thickest.
Well, the night don't think it's been on his feet, except when they first he first got in the ring. He's been on his back all night.
This is a different Bob Backlund than we have seen in the past,
he
I feel, Dick.
He threw the book out tonight.
He sure did. Backlund credited as being the most scientific wrestler to ever hold the World Wrestling Federation title. And we haven't seen any of that scientific knowledge displayed during this match, if you can call this a match.
Vince, you've never been cured.
The muscles rippling across the back of Bob Backlund as he rammed the elbow again into the facial area of John Valiant.
Valiant hasn't even got his jacket off, for heaven's sake. He was going about 5 minutes into this.
That's a very good point. You would think the referee would stop it long enough to get his jacket off. Oh, God.
I don't think Valiant has ever been mauled like this in the past. Not like tonight.
Backlund shouting for John Valiant to get up. I don't think he can.
I don't know.
Again, Backlund. Really attempt to rearrange the facial features of luscious Johnny Valiant.
Well, the only possible reason that this goes because it's a championship match tonight, Vince, but I've never seen a wrestler take so much punishment right off the bat, just constant. Now in the middle, that's, Backlund does it every time. He'll pull his adversary right in the middle of the ring, do it again.
Maneuvers on the part of John Valiant.
Now, I think all the fans watching right, both in here, the spectrum tonight, and at home, Vince, on Prism, will agree, as we would, that a pin could happen any time now. Backlund's really proving his point tonight. He came in loaded, prepared. Ringsiders standing, some of them still sitting around, just standing to watch it. They don't believe the way Backlund came in.
And there's a chance, believe it or not, there's a chance that Bob Backlund may become overconfident right now. He knows he has things in complete control. All it would take is one small error, and Backlund could find himself pinned. Oh, no. Mr. Ref, look at those feet. A point to be made. A moment ago when Backlund scooped up John Valiant, if in fact John Valiant could have wrapped Backlund, the small pocket could have grabbed the ankle, we could have had a quick pin. John Valiant is capable of doing...
Well, you just mentioned something, Vince. Backlund came down on the leg of Valiant, but seemed to hurt his own leg a little bit. Not noticeably, as you can see. So maybe that's the kind of mistake you're talking about. Oh.
John Valiant getting it from all angles, every which way.
Well, I just saw Dick Worley's lips form the word, you want to give up, and apparently
Again, it amazes me, as you brought out earlier, that, Dick Worley is continuing to allow John Valiant to wear his jacket.
Amazing.
I would think that'd be a disadvantage for John Valiant.
Yeah, it would seem so, Vince. Well, here's the first time that...
Oh, no.
I was going to say he finally got to his feet, but really didn't.
Backlund. Oh,
maybe really that's what you were talking about. A little bit of a mistake.
Oh, yeah.
All right, Backlund forced by down his foot into the rope turnbuckle. Anyway, here maybe seeing a turn. There's the head of Backlund jammed down on the mat. And now maybe we're going to see a response from Valiant on a continuing effort. Body slam.
Ah! John Valiant took too much time there. Way too much time. We see John Valiant recovering from his injuries earlier. No one can recover any quicker than Bob Backlund. That's the condition that this young man is in. Unquestionably, one of the greatest physical specimens in the world today is Bob Backlund.
Nobody can dispute that, Vincent. Oh. He's working on that left leg of Valiant tonight, just like he'd like to tear it off and eventually hit him over the head with it.
Most of the damage being done to the knee area.
Backlund still very much in control. Maybe Backlund sensed the hair pull there and elbowed him down. We saw that twice. There's a hair pull, which is very much in evidence, noticed by Dick Worley. At this point in time, if you were Giant Valiant, I think you'd probably try almost anything to get the upper hand. I think I would.
Well, surely John Valiant is capable of trying anything. He just has to have the opportunity.
You know, it amazes me in a way, Vince, although Jerry Valiant's going to be seen later on tonight on Prism. Why, surprisingly, his brothers haven't made the scene here to help him out. He's really taking a terrible beating.
Not only his brothers, but also the manager of the Valiant brothers, Lou Albano. This is really the Valiant brother night, so
That's
to speak.
Right.
Oh, my, that'll keep him down.
I think he
knocked himself cuckoo, didn't he?
He sure did. His eyes rolled around his head like one of these cartoons.
Bob Backlund, no S.D. Jones when it comes to a headbutt, apparently.
Apparently not.
Here's that case in point with that jacket. Now, how do you know whether that shoulder is down or not?
That's right. Some of the collar area feels...
Backlund, his throat landed right on the bottom rope, and the rope just... right up against his throat and obviously impairing Mr. Backlund's breathing at the moment.
They're right above us, only about 3 or 4 feet away. And you see both these men are really working hard just to stay alive in a sense. Backlund came down to that rope, as you said, Vince. I don't know how he can breathe at all. There goes the head into the turnbuckle. Valiant's starting to make a comeback here, you can see. Another blow to the head. For a third. Valiant starting to recover, I guess. Four.
And now, John Valiant has had several occasions to rid himself of the jacket and has not done so. Well, apparently the jacket's not bothering him. And I don't know if that jacket has a zipper on it or not or anything that can cut, but there must be a reason why John Valiant is continuing to wear the jacket.
It seems to have snaps on it. He's trying to wish anyway. Cut the wind from Backlund again.
You can see perhaps Dick return at this moment. But earlier from our vantage point, we could see some scrapes, some cuts along the inner right leg, I believe, of Bob Backlund. Apparently from the jacket, the zipper,
it could be.
From that.
It could be. Well, everybody's pretty much on the side of Brock Backlund, the champion, but I'll tell you, you got to wonder how the world Backlund is even still in the ring. Backlund's starting to get punished back again now, though. Nothing but a desire here for one man to really physically hurt. Here comes the jacket.
Yeah, but now watch what happened to the jacket. That's what we were talking about earlier.
Yep.
Now, John Valiant, since he has the upper hand, and obviously he does, from there, if he can sap the strength of Backlund just a bit more by choking, by cutting that all-important wind off, then perhaps John Valiant would then attempt to go for a pin, but he's not going for the pin.
Well, he's trying to punish Backlund again, as Backlund punished him earlier on. I don't know that I blame him. Backlund seems just to be almost lifeless. The fans, of course, starting to chant. They're trying to get Backlund to feed some of their energy to him. Getting Backlund's feet again, trying to get him back into control.
Well, a fellow like Backlund, the fan support makes all the difference in the world. I don't know that it necessarily has any effect at all on John Valiant, but it certainly has on Bob Backlund.
Well, I think Valiant's wrestling for his life tonight. He realizes that he had really a narrow escape early. Now he seems to be in control, and I give him a lot of credit, like him or not, give him a lot of credit for coming back the way he did. Backlund just, we've seen him do this before, just seen him going, reaching way down within himself there, getting strength together. Maybe this is the time.
Backlund using the back door of the, yes. Hooking the ankle there, and takes him down.
That had to take a lot of strength to do that, because he just literally caved on the canvas himself. Now back to the same hold again. Dick Worley asking, holding the hand up, asking for a submission. No way. Backlund reaching out, seemingly grabbing for strength somewhere in the outer, and you're in space.
Yeah, but the mark, did it ever. John Valiant bent over double now, and right back with the same hold. We made reference earlier to the absence of Lou Albano, the manager of John Valiant, in his most important match. I think we also have to make reference to the absence of Bob Backlund's manager, Arnold Skolin.
You know, I missed that, Vince. You're right. Usually Arnold Skolin's right on the inside, hold on to the belt while Backlund's doing battle. You're right.
Maybe the commission decided to keep them in the back room area and not allow them to come out around the ring. We've had on many an occasion good appearance on the part of Lou Albano, and believe it or not, once in a while, Arnold Skolin can get carried away.
Backlund is trying desperately to get it going again.
Rob Backlund landed a chop to the throat, and Backlund picks up the momentum. And right back at him is Johnny Valiant.
Maybe never, or in a long, long time, two men in the ring battling the way they have. This Valiant is everything in the game, and naturally Backlund is everything in the lead. He's going to need a man at this point.
Again, Backlund making his move.
Both men will sleep tonight.
One a bit more than another. Oh,
another headbutt.
And Backlund again. No. Backlund off the ropes now. Backlund pulled out the ring.
It's Valiant. Valiant's still trying to get himself together. I think he He reached
very clever move on the part of John Valiant. Just stepping aside. As Backlund, the momentum carried him out through the ropes. And there, Backlund now trying to get back in. John Valiant greeting him.
I think he's coming over toward the ring. Oh!
Right into the
shoulder. Shoulder blasted into that ring post.
And the ring post didn't feel a thing, did it?
Rick Worley counting. 5, 6, 7. All right. Jerry Bowdy trying to get after it.
Making his move again. Bob Backlund just hanging out on the apron in the ring.
Backlund. He can fire us like a shot.
Well, I tell you, he really let it hard.
Right, Backlund still being counted. Jerry Valiant on the out, or John Valiant on the
outside. John Valiant, Bob Backlund.
Jamming his head against the table where we are at ringside. Now pounding with his head again on top of the ring of paper.
Doing everything else in the kitchen sink there on this one is John Valiant.
Oh, body slam.
Backlund whipped to the rope, John Valiant sitting.
Oh! Not a lead lift at all, just brought his foot right up against under the chin.
Backlund had him in the air. Going for the atomic knee drop, he couldn't make it. Backlund wraps him up in his foul package, and there's the way! Backlund feeling his oats right about now. Listen to this ovation.
Well, Dick Worley holding the championship belt aloft and the arm of Bob Backlund.
13 seconds. The winner and still champion, Bob Backlund.
Mr. Backlund will be seen. Oh, look out! John Valiant took a swing at Dick Graham. Dick Graham's about 6'5", something like that. If you'd been standing up, you'd have felt that one. Good thing you were sitting down.
I think just the wind would have knocked you down.
You give me 5 more minutes with that yo-yo, I'll tell them every week.
Backlund going after John Valiant. Oh, what a top row.
Fans, I tell you, they've been doing wrestling for a while, but this, what an evening this is. Dick Worley trying to maintain some semblance of calm here. Every fan has to be on his feet tonight. Valiant just... He had to get the last word in. I think he... All right, we got a hand mic here. Hey, Bob. All right, we've got Bob Backlund coming down here. Champ, you're in a real battle tonight. What do you have to say about it? My God, you came on like 5 guys at the outset.
Well, I usually don't attack a match like that or attack a man like that, but after what he did to me last time at Spectrum, I was just outraged the way he come out with that slap at the beginning of the match, and that really burned me up. You know, a lot of things can happen after the bell rings, but a slap is very disgracing at the point that he did that in that match, and I never forgot it. And I hope I made him pay just a little bit for what he did.
Well, Champ, there's no doubt that you made him pay tonight, because I never saw anybody come on the way you did. And frankly, in all due respect to him, I don't know how in the world he took it.
Well, you got to give him credit. He's
all right, come on over here, Champ.
You got to give the man a lot of credit. He's tough. He's in shape. But
all right, we're going to see this. We're gonna see this pin, Bob Backlund. Make any comments you can as we watch it.
I thought I had him in, I got him in the cradle, and I had it in pretty good. I had my leg hooked in on the other leg of his, and he couldn't kick out, so I got the 1, 2, 3, and boy, that was the happiest moment I've ever had here in the Spectrum.
Well, I'll tell you one thing. I guess you're ready to go into the dressing room and come down if you possibly can. Ooh. Well, I wish you a happy birthday, all the fans here.
I got a big cake waiting for me back in the dressing room, but I never eat cake, but I'm going to give it all away if I can. It's beautiful thing that all these people here did.
Happy birthday to you.
I appreciate all of them.
We'll look for you again in October back here.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Bob Backlund on his way back to the dressing room, and while you were interviewing Bob Backlund, Dick, in the ring, believe it or not, again, is John Valiant. He hasn't had enough.
Well, Backlund is looking back toward the ring again from over on the side. He was ready to go off, and now he's...
Well, he has nothing to win by going back over there, I don't think.
Look up!
But here he comes! Oh, Backlund!
Oh, all right.
John Valiant changed his mind.
Well, Backlund made his point throughout the match tonight, and once again, exclamation mark. He said, all right, here I am, come on back. I'll tell you, Vince, what a man, Bob Backlund. You just heard him say a few minutes ago that he decided to really punish that man for making him look bad earlier, and he sure did. He came in with guns blazing, did Bob Backlund. Valiant finally going off underneath the... Well, it's all worthwhile to Backlund all the effort tonight, because he knows the fans are totally 1,000% behind him. And even the cake the fans very kindly made for him, the birthday cake, why, he said, I'll distribute it to somebody else. Shaking hands as he goes out.
Ladies and gentlemen, another reminder that the next card of Championship Wrestling set for the Spectrum is set for Saturday, October the 20th. That's Saturday, October the 20th, here at the Spectrum. We're going to break now for a short intermission. We shall return. Thank you.
Our fans, we'll be taking a little bit of a time out here. I need a breather. I guess you do, too. Those of you watching on very popular, Chief J. Strongbow approaching the squared circle tonight. And here he is in his Indian finest, if you will, the headdress. Of course, the tights. And as you said, as you predicted, Vince, he'd be wearing the knee brace on his left knee, and he is. So the Chief entering the ring now. And very shortly, we'll be waiting for the other half of this crucible, if you will, Greg Valentine. You'll know soon enough when he enters the ring area by listening for the crowd. The Chief looking to be in pretty good shape, if you will, jogging somewhat around the...
As again, a look at the knee brace.
Yeah.
He certainly put to rest recently any fears that some of his friends would have as to whether or not Jay Strongbow had his full mobility back.
Well,
even though he does wear the brace, you would have, again, some feelings of wondering whether or not... Oh, there's Greg Valentine.
Greg Valentine's catching the whole scene here tonight. And
that's a beautiful robe he's wearing, isn't it?
It's beautiful.
Strongbow just jogging around the ring. He is so unorthodox, there's just no telling what this man's going to do. And Valentine is certainly leery of Jay Strongbow. Look at him backing up. He wants Strongbow on the far side. Strongbow going after him.
Well, Valentine must have backed up about 10 feet from the ring on that one. Not to say he's a coward in the least, because you've seen him in the ring before. Valentine is all man.
Excuse me, look at that battered forehead of Greg Valentine. He has been through the mill.
nothing. Jace Longbow has it. Valentine, a very young man, but yet has been wrestling for any number of years now. He started, perhaps I think he started much younger than anyone else in the World Wrestling Federation, with the exception of Bob Backlund, who started when he was 10 years old wrestling.
I see the chief started to hand his headrest to one of the attendants and all looked over his shoulder to see where Valentine was. So there's a certain amount of respect there by both men. And any moment or two,
there's the leather, the strap now that
referee's applied,
putting it on Jay Strongbow's right wrist. And Mr. Valentine not too anxious to pick up the other end at this moment, at least.
If you'll notice,
ladies and gentlemen, the following contest is a special Indian strap match. It is set for one fall to a finish. Introducing the participants, in the corner to my right from Seattle, Washington, weighing 245 pounds, Greg Valentine. And wrestling fans, his opponent this evening from Pawhuska, Oklahoma, weighing 248 pounds, Chief J. Strongbow.
Valentine having a few words with the referee.
You started to say a moment ago, Vince, if you noticed the...
Look at... Oh, Strongbow whipping, literally whipping Greg Valentine.
Well, you're on... You're on Strongbow's turf tonight, so to speak, with that strap. He knows how to use it. I tried to point out, Vince, if you notice on the right wrist of Strongbow is a huge buckle.
Which, boy, I can see it.
And that's a deadly weapon. There's
no doubt of that.
Well, you fans watching tonight, don't blink or don't nod off or don't go out to any refreshment all of a sudden, because anything's going to happen.
Valentine is really not eager to have that locked around his wrist.
No, I think he feels that is the moment of truth. There's no escaping now.
What do you think he's complaining of? Oh, the buckle. Maybe that's it. Well, as you brought out earlier, that's what Valentine is complaining of. He's complaining of that buckle. Longbow pulling for all his worth of that strap across the neck of Greg Valentine.
While he's applying the pressure, Dusty Feldbomber, the referee, is applying the strap.
He sure is. So Strongbow, more or less,
they're together now.
Hogtied him, yes, indeed. Valentine,
woo! Well, we're underway, ready or not. I said earlier that strap would probably be used as a choker, and it sure is. Valentine.
Valentine trying to roll outside, and Strongbow keeps it from doing so.
Well, if you can liken this to training
a
horse.
Look at that. Look at the way Strongbow is using that Indian strap to his advantage. Again, Valentine trying to get away.
Away tonight.
The buckle on the strap that Strongbow was wearing. Likewise, Valentine has an exposed buckle around his right wrist.
I don't think that's tight enough on Valentine. Doesn't seem to be as tight as it is on the Strongbow. We'll find out. Well,
Valentine taking up the slack. Oh, going for the leg. Yes. And Strongbow right there whipping him without strap.
Very much feeling he's in control tonight against Greg Valentine, and I suspect so far he is, but tonight is young. Strongbow is seemingly as if he were breaking a horse, if you would. I don't imply that Valentine is such, but the way he's handling the strap, pulling.
Valentine has that strap around Strongbow's neck, head.
Now Valentine begins to beat Stronghold with a series of forearm smashes. Well, he's not being cute and strapped while he's pulling on the choke now. But earlier, he was just smashing away his Stronghold. Stronghold is down now. And Valentine started working that left leg. Not on the knee, though. He's hitting on the thigh area of Stronghold so far. Fellbottle starting to count the break the hold. He's right back again. This time, though, it's around Stronghold's mouth and not his throat. All right, Stronghold finally getting his feet. Stronghold,
oh! Greg Valentine.
Pulling him back now. Valentine looking for the edge of the ring, but he can't get away. Not tonight. Valentine's got to get back in the ring again the way it looks now. Or lose an arm. I think certainly Jay Stronghold is satisfied in his performance, at this moment at least, in this Indian scrap match.
Good shape tonight, although he has that leg brace on the knee, but he's very strong tonight. All right, there's another bit of a technique. Greg Valentine's taking a great deal of the
that's right, he's shortening
strap
that strap up. Shortening it up. But nevertheless, Stronghold, again using that knee brace, much as we saw last month.
Well, I assume his leg is getting stronger week by week as he continues to work on it, work out with it. There's a chop to the back of the knee by Valentine on the cheek. And there's a deliberate elbow to the knee. He's not fooling now. Valentine very much going for that one leg of the two Stronghold. Another knee back on the side.
Valentine was turning up the buckle part of the wrist strap there around so as to expose the buckle when he struck Jay Stronghold a moment ago.
See some blood tonight, I think. Well, there's the blood already.
Oh, sure. You brought out earlier, Dick, you saw that exposed buckle, and that's exactly what happens when that buckle hits the flesh.
Sharp edges on there. They're square buckles and not rounded off at all. Keeps upper chest area being somewhat covered by blood from his forehead now. Some of the concerned ring officials checking him out to see how far how much of a wound it is. Hard to tell at this point. But Valentine has the teeth pretty much. Oh!
Bronco just reeling around. Bronco is really in bad shape.
That's it, but he keeps coming back. He won't back away.
Valentine spinning around.
Oh! I think it's four leg lock, maybe.
Valentine cranking down on it. And Stronghold just able to keep that right leg of Valentine from locking up. And Valentine can get it over.
Well, we see the Keith bloodied as he is, the way we've seen Jake Valentine bloodied in the past. I don't know if I have any bearing on the outcome tonight. Right now, the idea being both men are sort of in a state of hold.
Well, Stronghold is really cut. Really cut
is.
Badly. I think the referee's going to stop it.
Oh, ho! Give me more now coming up. All right, Valentine did a swipe at Stronghold's knee, driving him down to the canvas again.
Boy, I think the referee is making a mistake allowing us to continue. Again, Valentine circling around. Now, what's he trying to do here?
Oh, he tried to take the brace off.
That's what he's doing.
Taking the brace off.
He has it unbuckled on one side. Bronco in such a shape, he's attempting to lash Valentine in the back with that strap.
He's not too effective right now, and he's trying to get the brace goes way down in the boot, apparently.
Valentine, what's that brace?
Oh, the chief may be onto something now. I don't know. He's trying to get that brace back up again, trying to strengthen it, but now he's taking off.
Oh, wait a minute.
Look out. Dusty Feldbaum literally took that piece of metal stripping that keeps Strongbow taken out of his brace aside. There's no weapon there. Strongbow still in command, if you will. Bad as he looks with the blood.
Valentine took that shot to the midsection, I think almost deliberately.
Oh, he's got some of the metal, Vince.
Some of the supportive metal on his side. Now Strongbow has it. Valentine hammered again. Strongbow belts him and lets him out.
Now Valentine is on the floor.
Yes, Valentine is cut.
He's cut. And the blood's flowing now, Vince. Both these guys are going to have to get blood donors by the ball.
Well, look what's bound to happen with that Indian strap, but Valentine, I'm sure, did not expect this to happen to be battered by the supportive metal brace that ran along the side, at least one of the sides of Jay Strongbow's knee. Valentine going outside. Strongbow hit it out there also. Strongbow is it.
Jesse Brown, he's got the strap now. Right.
Whoa!
Strongbow,
a bottle of the chair. Oh, Strongbow felt it.
Bell. I'm not too sure what Dusty Feldbaum. All right, there's the bell. Both wrestlers continue at it. And now, Rick Valentine's broken away from the strap. The strap entirely owned by Chief Strongbow.
Oh, look at
Valentine.
Oh,
wow.
Valentine rolls back in.
He's gone back in the ring to get away from Strongbow, but Strongbow right after him. As I said, he owns the strap now. Out of the ring again. Saying no more of this. What's no part of this again? I don't know. Must be over. Valentine going off to the dressing room area amid the booze of the ringsiders. Well, eventually, we'll get the decision here. What do you say, Vince? Disqualification, both of them, or what?
Well, I don't know. They were both on the outside, and they were both around the ring post.
All right, referee just explained the decision now. Let's get it.
Ladies and gentlemen, after 10 minutes, 28 seconds, both men counted out of the ring. Both men disqualified. The match is a draw.
Okay, disqualification, fans.
An unpopular decision here at the Spectrum, both on the part of the fans and I think perhaps on the part of the principals as well. Valentine had hoped to end it here tonight. Strongbow, certainly, he is incensed. Look at it.
Strongbow is upset. I mean, that is, that's the understatement of the century. Talking about him being upset. He headed off down toward the chute going toward the dressing room of Valentine, wanting more of him. And the Indians stalking off. The people stalking off now. Amid the cheers and plaudits of the fans. Nothing's been decided, though. This is the third time these men have met. And disqualification on both sides.
Well, they were counted out the ring, outside the ring. And, of course, that is the referee has to do his job. He certainly allowed all sorts of latitude in the bending of the rules and regulations. So you have to give the referee credit. In that instance, he wanted to see it end, but when they're outside, you've got to put the count on them.
Well, that's it. fans want to talk about more sports, this time football, because this is the season, or the beginning of the season. On Prism Television, want to tell you something very, very super special coming up. What with NCAA football, September 19th on Prism TV. It'll be September 29th. It'll be Temple versus the Pittsburgh Panthers across the way from the Spectrum at the Vet. So I hope you'll mark that date on the calendar, September 29th, NCAA football, Temple University, and the Pittsburgh Panthers on Prism TV live from the Vet. Okay, we're sort of in a holding pattern right now because very shortly we'll be looking for the giant one. My wife Rita and, that'll be coming up in a few minutes. We have Gypsy Rodriguez and Tito Santana. During the intermission tonight, my wife Rita and I stood on either side of Andre the Giant. I have a picture taken. I wish I could show it to you tonight. It's staggering. I'm 6'5". My wife is 5'5". And Andre Giant is just a skyscraper.
And he's 7'5".
7'5" is right. Just amazing. So that's one for my scrapbook. All right, Tito Santana, whom they like a great deal here, as they did with DiBiase.
Here's your 7 foot, ladies and gentlemen, in this corner, at 237 pounds, from Puerto Rico, Gypsy Rodriguez. And in this corner, 238 pounds, in all blue, from the city of Mexico, Tito Santana. This will be one fall with a 20-minute time limit. Your referee, Barney Solomon.
All right, Barney Solomon back in the ring, third man. I think he's taking his headdress off. And being checked out by the referee. Tito Santana, as we said, gaining a lot of local fan support here, as another young wrestler upcoming, Ted DiBiase, who we mentioned earlier. And here's the wily older man shaking off a proper hand.
Rodriguez is sporting a bald head.
Here, yeah.
Which we haven't seen in the past.
Well, no hair pulls for him tonight, or on him. He's very well bopped on the face there with the beard. Santana's sort of very deceiving, too. We're talking about Ted DiBiase and his size earlier, but he's built along the same lines, rather sleek by comparison, if you're going to compare him with Mikel Cicluna or someone else. But nevertheless, a lot of strength there. There's not much fat on these guys at all. All right, a count of two or three there. And Rodriguez with a backhand at Santana.
Very nicely executed by Tito Santana.
Right, beautiful.
Santana favoring his left leg a bit. A hold, but as we saw a moment ago, sometimes hurts the individual applying it just as much as the one on the receiver.
It's time for the ball, ladies and gentlemen. 7:48, your winner, Tito Santana.
The decision, of course. Take a look at the screen now as you watch the action leading up to the pin now. Santana coming down on the leg of Gypsy Rodriguez. Now, sort of a step over toe hold, as they used to call it, and now bending it further and going back to apply full weight as we get a count of one, two, and three. Here's a look at him. There's the man. There he is. There's the man, Andre the Giant.
You're going to be seeing not only in the wrestling ring, but Andre is not only the biggest single sports attraction in the world, he, I think, is soon to be one of the biggest television personalities in the world, because he just finished doing DJ and the Bear, and I think maybe he plays the part of the Bear. I'm not too sure, but I'm sure we'll be seeing Andre and many. Well, there's no telling what's going to happen once Hollywood gets a hold of this man. He is something else.
I saw Andre the Giant come up to the ring apron. Jerry looked up at it, and just his eyes sort of broke. Andre finally just threw one leg over the top rope to get it. Not go through the upper to the second strand. Over the top and walked.
This match is set for one fall with a 1-hour time limit.
Jerry Valley.
Introducing in the corner to my left from New York City, weighing 271 pounds.
You think he's worried? He's looking
for
the worried man,
Dick? Team championship, gentlemen, Jerry Valley. And wrestling fans, his opponent this evening from the French Alps, weighing 453 pounds, the eighth wonder of the world, Andre the Giant.
450 something. He's lost a little weight on that.
Yeah, poor fellow. He must be starved.
Yeah, it looks sickly, huh?
Yes, he does. Jerry Valiant has got to be thinking, who booked me for this? I signed my name to the contract. Did I really?
Look at the difference in his size for this referee and Andre the Giant. Look at this difference. Unbelievable, isn't it? Jerry Valiant is perplexed, to say the least.
He's trying. He's thinking, what the world?
I would imagine at this point he's saying, what in God's name did I do signing for this match? Andre's still smiling.
Hey, some are alert. Are alert.
Hey, look at that! Unbelievable. Andre gave Jerry Valiant one shove. And it was so hard that Jerry Valiant went flying over the top rope.
I wonder any time tonight of our alert director trying to keep a sense close-up of one of Andre the Giant's hands. All those hams, odd hands. Gee.
Look at the difference in the size. There's a good day.
Andre still smiling. Jerry's going to call out the National Guard, I think.
Andre back to the corner. Look at Andre just pushing him right out.
I think Jerry said I did something wrong.
Right, Jerry Valiant disappears. 260-pounder, 6'3", disappears behind Andre the Giant.
Jerry Valiant taking advantage of this turn of events.
Him again. Andre headbutt. Andre just keeps grooving right on in.
He does. He doesn't slow down at all. Well, Andre the Giant ain't fancy, but boy, he's a pester.
Jerry Valiant, that's the most unusual hold I think I've seen in a long time. And Andre just has it wrapped right his arm right around himself.
No. And the referee trying to find out if Valiant submits, but you know, there's no choke hold there, really.
Only Andre the Giant.
guy could apply that hold. No one else could. That was strength to hold the arms of an opponent.
Don't throw my way, Andre, please. That's it. You put him out in the press box next. Put Valiant up in the press box. You know, right?
If you're a referee in a match with Andre the Giant, I think you do a lot of asking.
Would you, sir, care to break?
Yes.
please, sir. Make a wish.
Oh, my.
Oh, wow.
Look at the size of that boot.
Look at the size of the boot. The boot goes from his heels up the waist area on Valiant.
Andre wears size 22 or 26, I believe. I don't. It's one of the two. I know there's a lot of difference. I guess there isn't really once you get up to that line.
What do you imagine about Andre the Giant as far as training is concerned? Do you think he's pumping a lot of iron or what?
No, Andre doesn't pump iron. He doesn't have to. He has such extraordinary ligament strength. Andre does a lot of calisthenic work and a lot of stretching work. Andre doesn't want to bulk up. Goodness knows he's 450 pounds now. If Andre the Giant were to start pumping iron, squats, deadlifts, and things of that nature, he'd blow up to 550 almost overnight. Andre, you know, as opposed to that, he has the strength. What can he do with more strength, you know? He can't do anything. He has all the strength in the world that he would ever need.
But he wouldn't be a jogger, you know, would you imagine that he would?
No, Andre doesn't do a lot of jogging, but he does a lot of stretching exercise and things of that nature. And a lot of cardiovascular plays, racquetball, handball, things of that nature.
So he just keeps limber more than anything.
I would say so, because anyone who has the schedule of Andre the Giant, as far as the workout is concerned, you get it in the squared circle. As often as this man wrestles, he has a schedule that's more rigorous than any other pro athlete in the world, in any field, any sport in the world. He's just a demand. That's the demand of an Andre the Giant.
Oh, look, now he's upset.
And Jerry Valiant is in a world of trouble.
Right above our broadcast location, Andre the Giant now unhooking the arms, and he's sending him into outer space, I guess.
Oh, she's Jerry Valiant. Really, look at her.
Well, he said, you're not getting away from me.
Jerry Valiant, oh, bent it off. Right into that huge foot of Andre. Andre, look up. One, two, it's right up. I hope we have a replay on that. Andre puts the squash on Jerry Valiant. Did he ever? I guess he'll be scraping Mr. Valiant up off the canvas after that.
Can you believe that?
Seven minutes, 34 seconds, and your winner, Andre the Giant.
Andre the Giant, over the top rope, the greatest sports attraction in the world today.
All right, as Andre the Giant goes off toward the dressing room, and here's a replay approaching the point of pin. Valiant in the ropes. Now the foot in the midsection, Valiant goes down.
Hard to slide ahead there, Dick, really nailed it. Oh, and look. Oh, no. Oh, forget about it.
Watch.
Are you kidding me?
Two,
give credit to Jerry Valiant for leaving the ring on his own power. Really. Which is, in fact, he's on his way back now.
Yeah.
Jerry Valiant leaving the ring. He's a tough customer to absorb that type of shock.
Don't believe it, Vince. I don't believe it. You know, it's funny. You see this championship wrestling here at the Spectrum so often. And as the crowd filters out now following this exciting evening, you just can't quite believe some of the tremendous showings of athletic prowess that we've had tonight. It's just been dynamite tonight.
It really has. Bob Backlund, I think, showed this crowd that Mr. Backlund can get turned on. And he really meant business right from the very beginning. And as he explained to you in the interview afterwards, he explained his feelings and that he felt he was a bit disgraced in his previous encounter here at the Spectrum. But John Valiant slapping him, which is unquestionably an insult.
He couldn't take that, and he said he came in really to do him harm. He really said, I really wanted to really hurt him, put the hurt on him, and he did. G. Chief Strongbow against again being disqualified, as was Greg Valentine tonight.
That was disappointing, I think, from the fan standpoint. I think probably a little disappointing from the participant standpoint also.
Well, they want to see a decision, and I guess we did too after the violent injury that was sustained by Strongbow some months ago, the figure four leg lock at the hands of Valentine. We thought that like last month that it would be all over, that Strongbow would come back again, but he didn't. And this time, sort of disqualification, and maybe it's setting up for another time. I don't know, but at least you can always find exciting Spectrum action here every month. Of course, we won't be back again in September. We'll have to wait till October 20th.
Yes, indeed, and I really look forward to the card on October 20th. I'm sure the promoters are going to put together one whale of a card.
Well, you saw it all tonight. I think nobody went away unhappy at all, whether you're at home or right here among the, I don't know how many thousand, 16,000, 17,000 people. Lining the seats at the Spectrum. They got their money's worth, as always, with professional wrestling. Vince, where are you off to?
Back to New England, I suppose. But I'll tell you, I always look forward to coming back to Philadelphia and coming back to the Spectrum, and because this is where it's all happening in this part of the country as far as entertainment is concerned, not only wrestling, but the best of everything is right here at the Spectrum, and I really feel pleased and really proud to be a part of it.
Well, the fans have really come alive. I was telling some friends the other day, a year ago this past winter, I think we had three or four total sellouts, like 20,000 fans a night for several months there. And, of course, they turn out in droves here. Well, that's about all from ringside here at the Spectrum. Vince McMahon, yours truly, Dick Graham. We'll be looking for you not next month in September, but in October on the 20th. Meanwhile, those of you who want a good night out, get your tickets and come on here live and see it as it all transpires at before your very eyes at the ringside at the Spectrum.
It really is something, Dick, to feel the electricity. I mean, it's great. It's a great television event, wrestling is, because of the confining area and the personalities and everything. But in addition to that, to sit here and to feel the electricity, and it's just something else again. It's a wholly different thing altogether.
Well, I never get blasé. I look forward to my monthly stay here in an evening with you, and always will. So it's great for me, and I know it's great for you. Vince, we'll be looking for you then in 2 months, and I'll be back then, too.
Pleasure.
And all you fans have a good night now, and certainly a good rest of the month, and look forward to September for all the wonderful events on Prism Television.